Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. And let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words,
what do you prefer, security or opportunity? That is a great question, and it is amazing. I mean, it seems to be that is an easy answer for that one, but it's not that easy anyway. So, good morning. We are streaming live from Southern California, here in the United States. Benvenuti a tutti. Bienvenido todo el mundo. Hemos tenido a lot of people as an attendees, and I have received multiple different DMs about this particular subject. So it seems to me that it's very popular. I mean, people are very interested about this. So do I, by the way. I like everything that is related with the economy and the industry. So the combination of the two, I mean, it's something that I greatly appreciate because it called my attention and keep me alive in a way. Because when you experience changes, then you tend to grow. So that's my personal introduction about this subject. I wake up this morning and the first thing that I have is a coffee. And now we are gonna have a coffee in Canada. How about that? Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everything with you, Benita?
Really good. The weather is nice. It says it's 18 degrees Celsius and sunny. So that's like 70 something Fahrenheit.
Wow. So no question about it. I mean, the weather has changed in lovely Canada.
Yes. And then tomorrow we're going to have a downpour of rain.
Okay, that's always good to experience. So what do you think about this particular subject?
Well, and you know, I find the question very interesting, like, do I prefer security or opportunity? Uh-huh. It's like the normal person is like, I want both, right?
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
Uh-huh. But, you know, in order, it feels like in order to have security for the normal folks, in order to have security, you have to work for someone else. And then, uh-huh. But really, it's very debatable whether that's secure or not in these days with all these layoffs going on, right? And then it feels like if you want opportunity, you have to go on your own, and that's scary. We've been doing it for a while, but that's scary. I still remember how scary it was at the very beginning.
Of course. Again, I mean, I don't want to have a spoiler here about the conversation, but there's very interesting. I mean, no question about it. I mean, as I said at the beginning, I have received a lot of DMs from people that, I mean, probably new to the program, very interested about, I mean, what is going to be the subject about and stuff like that, having questions, sharing also some stories. So this particular program, it seems to be that I have to have two parts. One that is what we plan for today, and then the second for all the recollection of all experiences and so on and so forth. Because it is important. It is something that definitely people feel like is taking over so many different, let's say, in the way that we see the labor market. Now, before we are gonna start, I would like to hear from everyone on the audience where they are tuning up from. As I said at the beginning, I mean, I have received a lot of DMs from people, attendees over 200. That is amazingly special for us, because that represents that the subject is very important. It's something that people are experiencing and something that they feel connected with.
I think everyone is interested in this topic. Okay, yeah. We have Aura. Hi, Aura. Is she in Southern California too? Yes.
Yes, she is. Aura is in Southern California. Definitely. I don't know exactly what part of the Southern California, but she is. I mean, probably she's going to be able to share with us. I mean, where she's tuning out from.
Gustavo, I've let him know to turn his volume up or double tap on the picture, because sometimes, you know, when you just tap once, then you get our screen, but then you tap twice and you're in.
Right. You can show some comments in the meantime. I mean, I'm going to try to do something here, which is basically I would like to mention people that I have received some direct communication. So I'm trying to get to that point. Technology is not always something that is flexible or is working with me, but we'll see. It's going to take me probably 5 minutes to get to to that.
Okay. Glad you're with us now, Gustavo. We have, I think this is Felix. Yeah, this is Robert Felix from South Africa.
Oh my gosh.
Yep.
That's South Africa
in the house.
Beautiful destination, by the way.
Yeah. We have John Y. Ford from, I think it's, am I going to get it wrong or right? Is it Pennsylvania or Philadelphia? Do you remember?
I believe that is Virginia.
Oh, okay. Got it.
Believe. I'm not sure. I mean, he's going to let us know just in a few seconds, I guess.
He's probably getting sick of telling us.
Yeah, you may be right about that one.
Well, everyone's here to talk about the gig economy.
Yeah. Oh my God, we have David from Nigeria.
Oh my goodness. Hi, David.
So real quick, I can't get to the point that I would like to, but anyway, it seems to me that I have to move forward. So if I can get to it, then I will. I would like to mention, I mean, those folks from different side of the world that they have.
Hi, Sarah.
Communication.
Sarah Mohammadi is here from Germany. Virginia, you're right. Okay. Sorry, John. Jose knows better than me.
Oh, yeah. He confirmed that it's from Virginia, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. We've got Germany here. We've got Nigeria. Cool. Thanks for joining us, guys. We're going to be talking about the gig economy today. And Jose started off by asking, would you rather have security or opportunity? So put your answers in the comments. Would you rather have security or opportunity? And we'll see.
Now, do you think that we should start with our particular and personal answer about that one? Well, let's leave it for the end. But let's try to move along through the conversation, because definitely I have my personal opinion and personal experience as well. But I don't want to lead the witness.
Okay. Well, let's start with the definition then.
Yes, that it would be a good point to start.
Okay, the gig economy is a noun. It's a labor market characterized by the prevalence of short-term contracts or freelance work as opposed to permanent jobs. And then in quotation marks, used in a sentence, working in the gig economy means constantly being subjected to last minute scheduling. I tend to agree with that. There's a lot of last minute scheduling and wow, it's really fly by the seat of your pants.
Now, I had a conversation, and this is something that I have heard before, right? When someone says that I'm a freelancer, I remember that someone, and this is something that I hear from a couple of people already. So it seems to be, I don't have that perception, but people do. So it's something to consider as well. And they said something like this: if you said that you are a freelancer, that means that you are unemployed. it seems to be that some people have used that when they are looking for a new career or new
job. Oh, I see.
They said that they are freelancers. I disagree with that, but that's part of the perception of the people out there, right? If you said that you are a freelancer, then that means that you are an employee.
Mm-hmm. Or it could mean that you take, you know, any jobs, small projects, you know, work assignments. Now, I mean, I think that's the real definition.
Right. Yeah, that it would be good. Because definitely, I mean, for someone that is doing freelancing, oh man, I have a lot of respect for those people because they have far the regular standard, which is just working for a company and stuff like that. And they have probably enough confidence in order to be able to go on their own and do something that is adding value to the labor market. And if they feel comfortable doing that, then it's something that not everyone can do it. That's for sure. And then,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Do you want to hear, like to be freelance is just to be independent and not employed by one company, right? Is the definition.
And the problem with that, I mean, I believe, is that we tend to use those buzzwords and then keep using it, and then the real meaning disappears because it's being used for many different things, like so many other words that we have in our regular use. So very interesting. I mean that point of view from those folks that I spoke, so implying that a freelancer is someone that is unemployed. Very curious. Probably is going to be the business person, right?
Because
the freelancer, let's say that I am an accountant, for example, right? Mm-hmm. Not only this is my professional life, accounting, but before I'm going to be able to do that, which is probably the core competency that I have to go to the marketing side and be able to promote myself, and then probably experience part of the sales because I have to sell my services for me to be contracted by someone or a company. So that person not only is focusing on the accounting side, but is going to different verticals where probably does not the expertise, but that person have to go and explore all these verticals just to be able to.
I totally relate to that. And so does John Y. Ford. You know, like right now I'm a inside salesperson, customer service. I help people with immigration. And I also consult for trade and compliance.
Yeah, and it's amazing. I mean, it's very diverse. That's for sure. So my whole entire respect for those that they are freelancers or they are in the gig economy, because it's not easy. It's not easy.
Right. So, and I guess we are unemployed. We're unemployed by one big company.
Yeah, that's probably the right way to see it, right? It's not that you're looking for a job, but you are unemployed by one single company. That is correct.
That's right.
So the gig economy has transformed the logistics and supply chain as well. And not only the logistics and supply chain, but also in multiple, I would say that the whole entire labor market is being affected by the gig economy. In today's environment, and not only, okay, I have to start with some, let's say, some history. Let's say prior COVID, still that was something that it was happening at a slower pace, maybe, and something that triggers that spike up, it was COVID. During COVID, definitely because many people have to be at home, and then they have to start exploring all these particular options because, let's say, generally speaking, I mean, you have to make a living, then basically you have to use all the resources that you have. And then not being able to go out, then you are forced to think and be creative. So the part of that, I mean, is when we start seeing that particular spike up in the gig economy, no question about it. So the answer to, is the gig economy transforming the logistics and supply chain and so many other areas of the job market? The answer is yes.
Well, I found that I Googled and I found how many, it told me how many US workers are in the gig economy. And this is just for the US. It's estimated that 36% of US workers take part in the gig economy and 33% of companies extensively use gig workers. The word gig refers to the transient nature of the job itself. The gig economy definition encompasses all sorts of contingent work arrangements.
Just continuing that path of the figures, because I like the figures because it is showing you the picture. And then maybe what is that heading to? As you mentioned, I mean, 36 in 2023, that number is from 2023, no question about it.
Oh, is it?
Yes.
Are you
seeing
the same numbers?
Yeah, I've seen those numbers before.
Okay.
So this is something very, very particular. In China, for 2023, they have an account of 200 million people working in the gig economy. Now, here is the very interesting part, and it's something that we should pay attention. 2036, they project to have 400 million people working in the gig economy.
Okay, that's like the size of the US.
No, that's for China.
I know. But then in 2036. The size of the US population in China will be gig workers.
Yeah, absolutely correct. Yes.
I think that's what I meant. Yeah. Right.
That's exactly right. So that is huge, huge. Now I have to comment on something that I personally believe. I remember like 5 years ago, because with my consulting company, the consulting is something that is going to be a kind of passion for me and probably for you as well. And one of the reasons that I decided to go that path, I mean, I'm talking about, I mean, like 12 years ago, when I started thinking about, I mean, what it would be something besides working for an organization, what I can do that is going to be a sustained over time. And I did some research and questions and talking about people about the economy and the labor market and stuff like that. And back then, I'm talking about almost 12 years ago.
Okay, yeah.
I determined that consulting is something that maybe is going to put you in that path where you are going to have something to do. I mean, I'm talking about work-wise, something to do on a regular basis where you're going to be with a company, where the economy is going to be bad, good, or whatever. It's something that you can continue, but you have to start building that up. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the reasons I always recommend to people to, I mean, what is your core competency and create a company around that, because that's exactly what is going to give you some sort of security, we can call it. I know that at the beginning it doesn't sound like a security. It sounds more like an adventure. but
a journey.
Right. But over time, I mean, you are getting solid and let's say 5 years, 10 years, even in some, I mean, for every single person is different. But in over time, you are getting more stronger than you were when you start. So now talking about the future, I mean, the uncertainty about the future is something that always we think about it, right? So, but the best way to counter the uncertainty is when we plan and we try to be strategic about something. And that is something that definitely is going to help you out to that. So 12 years ago, I said that there's going to be a lot of geek work. I didn't mention it like a geek work because probably that word, I mean, didn't exist back then. But I thought that that's probably the future, because I love those stories when you have a Rolex, right? Because you have been 20 or 30 years in the company, they change the plates, whatever, right? But that story is no longer a picture of in the labor market. So it's very unstable. And 12 years ago, it wasn't that drastic like it is today. So more so, definitely the gig world is something that is going to be probably present in our life. And the future, I would say that is going to keep growing. For China, they estimate that it's going to be 400 million people. That's huge. That's huge.
My story is very different than yours.
I'm sorry?
My story is very different than yours.
Okay, tell us your story.
I never really heard yours really before. I mean, I assumed, but mine is, you know, like when I was young and I was working in an office and I was climbing that corporate ladder, I always thought, oh, I want to be like this, that retired person that came back in to work as the consultant. Ooh. And then, you know, in Alberta, the oil and gas industry is not really, it's a boom bust type of thing, right? So it's a boom and they hire a lot of people, and then bust, it's like you're gone. So after two busts, I decided, oh, okay, I'm going to take this course and learn how to be a consultant and start my own business. And then on the other hand, I had an ex-manager that wanted me to be a consultant to his new firm. So I was like, yeah, I think that's what I'll do. Because, I mean, I was unemployed before I started freelancing. And then, you know, you piece things together, because it's just like what, you know, the Indians say, one drop of water becomes, you know, a bucket, and then a bucket becomes a stream. And then, you know, presumably you get to the ocean, but not a lot of people stick to it, right? So yeah. You being in it for 12 years is highly admirable. So congratulations, Jose.
Yeah, I mean, you know that when I don't take my medicine, I mean, I do crazy stuff, right? Just kidding. So definitely the gig economy has transformed everything in the labor market. And how they're been transforming that, I mean, by providing new staffing options. And we need to be very careful on this, because we, or the labor market, is doing it for different reasons. But definitely the positive thing is that providing new staffing options, that's way I mean, is way right there. I mean, what we should be paying attention to. And basically, I mean, because we have the freedom to pick and choose as a consumers, right? On-demand services, right? So we don't, a regular person, like let's say for example that I don't work, but I have a lot of money and I don't have to do anything, but I don't know what to do with the money. So I can hire someone for that specific activity that is going to be able to help me out, and it's going to be absolutely perfect, right? So there's this dynamic about the gig economy is very good, because now people feel more comfortable that to be specific on demand for the specific services. So, however, this brings some challenges, because for everyone that is in the gig economy, probably one of the most difficult aspects is everything related with the fair wages. I know some companies that they said, you know what, let's explore, because in the past, many companies dealing with a consultant, dealing with someone that is going to be in the gig economy, it wasn't that common. And even some companies, they have some regulations that they said, we are not able to work with consulting companies at all. And I seen those companies are not small corporations, even big corporations in so many cases. Now, everything has shifted little by little, and they go to the job market and try to hire people from the gig economy just to reduce everything that is related with the payroll. So it's more than a strategic, it's not that they value very well those services. It's just because it's an strategic, I mean, to balance the books, right?
Right.
So I said, you know what? If I'm going to hire this person, I mean, I can pay more or less the same salary. In some cases, I've seen that they said, okay, I can squeeze what I'm paying, let's say, to, let's say that a regular operator for some department in freight forwarding, for example. You're going to be an ocean expert. An ocean expert person, and he said, okay, here in the company I pay $50,000 or $60,000 plus 30% for benefits. That's what the company pays. So I can go and hire someone from the gig economy.
Yeah, like a freelancer, a consultant, an independent contractor, professionals, and temps, like temporary contract workers.
And then pay probably, I don't know, not even the 50,000, probably even less, but I don't have to pay the 30% for the benefits, because a contract basis is one number and forget about everything else. So that's probably the challenge that I see in the industry, is that companies do it for different reasons, and fair wages is probably what is probably the most important part for everyone that is in the gig economy. Now, because the coin always has two different phases. Now, from the company side, I understand why they hesitate to go to the gig economy and get some support, because number one, I mean, they question the quality, they question also the credibility of those professionals, and in many cases, I mean, if they are dependable or not. So that is fair. That is fair, because when you hire someone that is going to be in the other side of the country, let's say that many companies in Philippines or South America or you name it, I mean, they have some support. I mean, it's very difficult to determine, I mean, if they are doing everything that they're supposed to be doing, or they are fulfilling the commitment that they are doing, because you can see them. Now, sadly enough, I mean, everything has to be based on results, and sometimes the results have an explanation. But because you don't see it, then the first assumption is that they are not doing what the agreement was. Just to keep the conversation on the numbers, in 1989, the gig work was only 17% here in the U.S. economy. And in 2020, Louis is not in agreement with me, right?
Yeah, Louis, asking you to check your stats, maybe.
Hey, Louis, how are you doing?
This is my coworker in the gig economy.
Yeah, I'm sorry. You can too, Louis. So in 2020, we see a 43% in the U.S. market working as a in the gig economy. And this is a recent survey that determines that. In that survey, also something very interesting that I found is that when the question is being made about, I mean, do you prefer security or opportunity, the 50% of that they prefer security. 55% prefers security. Yeah. And just 35% of that survey, they prefer opportunity. 35% only. So
that makes sense.
Yeah, no,
it matches with the numbers that we gave out earlier.
Right. Now, of course, that is a good reason. And one of the good reasons why the opportunity preference is, let's say, on the lower side, I'm going to imply this because that's probably was my experience. When you are growing up, and basically with not a bad intention, of course, your family, your parents, your school, your environment basically is telling you, okay, you have to go get some education and then look for a good job and try to keep that job and then keeping that route, which is by default, I mean, you know, that's the right way to do it. Look for a job, get hired, try to lay low and maintain that job for 20 years, 30 years, get retired from that company, and that's basically everything. And it is good because it's, let's say, semi-secure back then. Today it's not that secure, but when we start talking about the gig economy, well, the opportunity is something that should be able to consider because that mentality where people are not afraid to explore different avenues is all this development that we have seen in tech in so many different things. It's amazing. I mean, how great we have grown as a human being. Right?
Well, it says that 44% of the gig economy actually relies on their income as their primary source. 44% only of that 36%. So that's very few people when you think about it, still to this day. But how I think about it is we're kind of like all part of a barter market too, because a lot of being in the gig economy is that you know others in the gig economy and then you barter your services, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
So it's kind of like going back to the old day, but with technology.
Right, right.
In that way.
I remember something that always inspired me. I remember that speech from President Kennedy. Oh. And if I'm mistaken, it was 1963 or something around that area.
Okay.
In Rice University in Texas, when he was talking about, I mean, going to the moon and so on and so forth. Thanks to people that they have that thinking, right? That mindset, that is not because the question is not, is this possible or not? It's just that they are going to do it anyway, even though that there's no ground work that is being done prior to give you the security that is something that you can achieve. But thank you to those people in that mindset is what we see all the advance in many different aspects in our life, right? The fact that we are able to communicate, we are able to have a community in CoffeeBreak Logistics and Supply Chain, that we are going to be able to use LinkedIn or some other source to be able to stream live and get connected, exchange ideas. learn, for example, I'm learning every single day that I interact with people. And it's amazing. I mean, we can do it if all these kinds of stuff, I mean, from someone that it was considered probably crazy at one point, I said, nah, that's not working. That's you're dreaming. But happened to be that thank you to those people is when we can experience something greater in our life. I love proving them
wrong. And I like, obviously there's like this saddest part of me that is like, let's see if I'll starve.
So just to summarize the past, it was a stable jobs, predictable careers, a way to increase the salary in that environment is not too many ways. One is working overtime.
Right.
The other one is wait for the performance review every single year and see if the employer is going to give you 2% increase or 3% or 4%.
Right.
And
because we all trust those performance reviews and think they're effective. Yeah.
Right. And the other one is if you are a high performer, then wait for the promotion. That's in that environment, that's the only way that you're going to be able to increase your income. So I'm not saying that is a bad strategy. What I'm saying is it's very limited. I mean, it's a box. It's a sandbox that you have to play with.
Yeah, so there's nothing wrong with being in that box. I mean, I've been in that box and, you know, it was good while it lasted.
And the most important is if you know the rules, so you know you may know the results. So if that picture is okay for you, yeah, keep that path. But if it's not, you need to be aware there's options.
Right.
And how about two things at the same time? The formal job in that structure that we have spoken before, plus a part of the gig economy, something that you can do on the
right.
side.
I think there's a lot of people doing that. They're more than you know. Like, I know quite a few people that have, you know, full-time professional jobs. And then in their free time, they do MLM marketing or they have a side hustle. They sell jewelry. They make lotions. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. I mean, and that's completely valid, right? Now, I experienced those two at the same time, and I did it for many years. And it is something that has a great value, not only because you are building something that over time is going to be very, very well positioned, right? And at the same time, I mean, you experience the beauty of working for a big corporation or whatever the case may be, because there's beauty in it. Now, I can tell my experience working for, let's say, an international freight forwarder. What I love about that experience is that you have the ability to meet people all over the world and learn the culture. Mm-hmm. Learn how they think, how to do business, which is very important. I mean, if you're going to be in the gig economy doing
right, while somebody else pays the tab,
right? So why are you going to be inventing the wheel if the experience, direct experience, is there? So I can verify all these boxes, right? So right. In the time doing it, doing those things at the same time, I mean, I learned a lot. And I was moving the learning aspect of that to my personal activity, my professional activity as an independent contractor or consultant or whatever the case, whatever is the name that we would like to use for that. So I was shifting all the knowledge that I gained going through.
Absolutely. It's all cross applicable. I think that the one thing that I miss is the camaraderie and like that feeling of having a second family, but I'm learning that that can happen in the gig economy as well. And
yeah,
it's you would expect it to work.
And like everything else, I mean, in the way that we are forced to develop something, then we are going to be able to do it because that's the human being, right? That's the true aspect of the human being. We are going to adapt and we are going to develop from there. So yes, having meetings, meeting with the people, shaking hands is something that is very particular, something that is a different experience. But it doesn't mean that we can do that online, let's say, right? More difficult is different. You have to be creative, you have to be open, but in a way, it is doable as well. Personally, me, I won't replace me shaking hands and just saying hello online. But whatever is going to be the limitation, then if the only option is the virtual option, I will do it. Looking for to have
I feel like it's not this or that, but in the gig economy, it's building a community. And I think people will start to understand that a lot more in the future, is that you build that community the way that you would experience that camaraderie inside of a big company. And but your community is outside of, you know, a company.
And now we talk about the past, we talk about, I mean, how the picture, I mean, how everything looked like in the past. Now the shifting, why is that happening, right? So, and that's something that we need to acknowledge, because otherwise we are going to miss the train.
Right. Well, people want to be free and they want to be independent. They don't want to be at the mercy of a big corporation. And especially with, you know, the reputations of corporations lately, we've seen haven't been all that stellar. People are more worried about ESG, the environment, social and governance. You know, they want to be on the right side. And some of them feel like, you know, they have a purpose or a calling, even.
Right. Now, I have one particular opinion, because for those that they promote the gig economy based on that, those points that you just described, I mean, they are good. But in a way, many people create that feeling that the big corporations is something bad, and it's not bad. It's not bad, because if I'm going to be in the gig economy, my customers, my part of what I do is going to be directed to those big employers.
Yeah, so if you're in B2B like we are.
Right. Now, yeah, absolutely. So big corporations, they're not bad. Working for a company is not a bad thing. It's just that it's different. And then we need to, when we understand our role and what exactly we'd like to pursue, then is what becomes clear and easy. But it's not a battle between all
organizations. No. I think John puts it really eloquently here. I use my experiences as a gig worker to enhance my consulting work. What we have to remember, gig workers are pretty much the ultimate expression of last mile logistics. Interesting.
It's right on point. I mean, by the way, John is someone that always got probably the brightest comments that I have seen for over 2 years. He's very right. I mean, he's on point.
Always on point and very eloquent.
Yeah, I respect his opinion very much, because I have learned about his comments a lot. So thank you, John, for
sharing. We appreciate you.
Now, talking about that particular shift from one side to the other, definitely something that is key is the consumer behaviors. So that is also changing, and that is promoting that gig economy, because the consumer behaviors, and you may say, well, why is that affecting that? Well, in a big way, because I'll just give an example. Let's say Starbucks. We know Starbucks is a corporation, they hire people. By the way, they have some labor issues that are being disputed at this point. I don't want to get into that, but whatever the case is. So we know the frame of Starbucks. Now, someone in a basement can have an idea that I'm gonna do a coffee membership, for example. and I'm going to be packing small bags of coffee from different countries. And then
that sounds fun.
And then I'm going to promote that on Instagram, for example. And then I have customers. I have new customers. I'm not saying that I'm planning to compete with Starbucks. What I'm doing is just an idea, right? So people feel, based on my proposal or my business plan, people are going to be appealed to that. Oh, you know what I mean? He would like to promote, let's say, growers in different countries where they don't have access to these big corporations, like they are going to buy the coffee like a Starbucks does with some growers directly. So new option, an opportunity, and then people feel very, very connected with that idea, then it's going to be a consumer that I'm going to have that is going to be completely different from the consumer, the regular consumer for the Starbucks, right? I don't know. Right. I just want to elaborate an example on the fly, but consumer behaviors basically create and promote these gig works.
Right.
Globalization and technology is probably the key two elements that are the main reason why the gig economy has grown to the point that we have seen it. And for those years to come, I mean, it's going to keep growing, because I love the globalization. I know that it's good and bad, but I love it anyway. I love the positive side, and the technology side is the same thing. Those things together.
I'm pro-trade.
Right. And another aspect that is important, and I know that probably people are going to be thinking different, which is okay. The education. So in the way that we acquire education, and I'm not talking about only the regular way to get educated. I'm talking about everything that is can call education. So in the way that you're going to be able to acquire that education, then you are going to be opening your mind to different ways. And you're going to be able to adopt something that probably is going to be beneficial for you and your family. So, hey, that's the shift that we are seeing. Another good influence of that is politics, but I don't want to talk about politics today.
No, we can't get into politics in the last 13 minutes.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, I mean, it's going so fast. Now, people misunderstand when we are talking about the gig economy, because some people tend to believe that because cheaper labor is the main reason behind the gig economy. Oh, I'm going to be able to get cheaper labor if I go to the gig economy. And that's not the case. And I would like to run through an example about, let's say, iPhones. an iPhone, right?
Okay.
We said, well, Apple is probably one of the biggest corporations. I mean, we are talking about from the revenue standpoint and so on and so forth. So I won't get into those details, but people said, okay, the biggest corporation here in the United States, I mean, do the manufacturing in China. So they move all the jobs from here to China. And so the whole craziness about that, that's not the case, 100%. Yes, China is the assembly country of those, but the components are coming from many, many different places around the world. So it's not that Apple moved the production, the whole entire production of the iPhone to China just to take advantage of the cheap labor. No. The war is in this particular, I mean, talking about this program in the iPhone, which is probably the best seller for Apple. So many countries take advantage of that huge business. Let's put it like that. And talking about US participating on that, Korea, Germany, there's many countries that they provide part of that, what is needed for the production of the iPod. The final product that we see on the stores is not only China. China is only the assembly country. And
that's of course,
yeah, they produce some other let's say parts for that. So the labor, I mean, the price of the Apple, the one of the cell phones, let's say that is around $1,000. Just assume that is $1,000. So 400 of those goes to labor, and 600 of the remaining value goes to different things like a finance, advertising, distribution, design, where
interesting,
where basically these are done in some different parts of the world, including here in the United States. So it's not entirely that many manufacturers here in the United States move to China because the cheap labor. There's more to take on an account for that. In 2001, when China joined the WTO, yes, the United States suffers like a 3 million people reduction on due to that, because part of the manufacture was moved elsewhere, including China. But it's not exclusively to China. And again, this is a subject by itself, definitely. But
yeah, no, that's a huge other subject. And we've probably lost Rob because he's totally against iPhones and Apple.
Yeah,
he doesn't eat the forbidden fruit, he says.
I love Apple technology, and I'm very connected with my iPhone. So, So, what are the type of jobs that we are going to be seeing in the future?
You know, when we say gig economy, mm-hmm. we often think of Uber or Lyft drivers, TaskRabbit workers, Airbnb landlords, online marketplace sellers, and artists, right? But the list should also include on-call workers, multiple job holders, contingent and part-time workers, highly skilled contractors, seasonal workers, consultants, and many others. And I mean, like, there's not anything I can think of that, you know, you couldn't potentially get online, except for, like, you know, the people that build your house.
Right. And probably we are going to get in some changes in that area as well, because the routine production is going to be little by little is going to be just disappearing, as someone that is going to be hiring people to do routine production. Because robotics, right? So the technology is going to be playing a good role on that. Something that is going to be on the rising up is personal services. Personal services is something that definitely is going to increase. And here is probably the most important part: symbolic analytics, right? And by symbolic analytics, I'm meaning problem solving, everything related with problem solving, which is created word, right? Just doing analysis about words, numbers, whatever that means, or whatever that is. So that's basically it. That's what we are going to be seeing happening. So those are the type of works. And I have something that I would like to show. So let me see if I can show what it would be probably the future of those jobs. I'm going to have it on the screen for a couple of seconds. Okay, now I remember how I was planning to do that. So bear with me 1 second. I'm going to show that in just a second. Okay. So basically, what? Let me see if I can bring that in on. Oh, it's right there in the background, right? So we see three different columns, right? And this is the kind of symbolic work that we are going to find. If you pick one of the first column and one of the second column and one of the third column, that it would be probably something that we haven't seen before, or we are not seeing it that often today, but it would be very normal to see it in the future. Financial process designer, for example, project strategy consultant, a resource application advisor. Those jobs probably in the past is something that we didn't see often, but we are going to see that more often moving forward.
Good to know.
What do you think, Benita?
I am surprised to see business policy manager, but it makes sense.
Yep. Those are the, where we like it or not, where we want it or not, those are the things that we are going to see. So we, in order to be prepared for the future, we need to change as well and see the market in a different way and probably be more close to the gig economy, because I'm not trying to answer the question that we did at the beginning for everyone, but for me, only for me, if I have to pick and choose between security and opportunity, I will stay with opportunity. No question about it. Why? Because income doesn't have any cap. I can do everything that I want to do, and I can grow as big as I can. So that's my preference. What would be your preference?
I'm sticking to my guns. I can't choose between either. Okay. And I feel like the opportunities may come with security in some cases, and security may come with opportunity. So I'm going to be, my answer is still the same. I want both. I want to have the cake and eat it too.
that's a great point. Definitely.
Is that the same, or is it pie? No, it's cake.
and I love this subject. And basically, I have two different things just to come in as a closing. What to change in this gig economy is probably the labor protection that have to be in place, right? That's something that definitely I would like to see that is going to be improving every single time, because
whole new conversation.
Yes. So I would change that, more labor protection for those in the gig economy. And something that we have to stop doing is, from the corporations, the companies, is just to think about that, how am I going to be able to reduce my payroll using the gig economy? I have to take advantage of the whole entire value that is there and pay them well. Pay them what is fair, what is competitive. And it's a win-win for everyone. Someone in the gig economy is going to be receiving the benefit of being in that condition, but at the same time, I mean, the corporation, the big corporations can influence that change that is going to be taking place regardless of we would like it or not. As always, it's been an absolute pleasure, and it make me believe, not only today, but it's something that I believe all the time, is that we are better together because we win together. Benita, thank you so much for your insight. I mean, it's always great value on that.
Thank you all so much for joining us, Miguel, John, Robert. Who else did we have? Yvette, was it Yvette? David. Thank you all, Gustavo. Aura, thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you next week.
Next week, 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time.
Here 11 a.m. Mountain.
In Canada. There you go. Bye-bye. Ciao.